Okay, the first test that we're going to study for convergence is called the integral test. Of course, to understand the integral test, we first have to understand integrals. So let's review what improper integrals are. We're interested in integrating a function from 1 to infinity, and well, we know what it means to integrate a function from a to b. It means we write it as a limit of a sum where we chop things into pieces. The trouble is, you can't chop the region from 1 to infinity into n finite pieces. So instead, we integrate from 1 to a large number b. And that does make sense. That's a limit as we chop that finite interval into lots of pieces. And then we consider what happens as we integrate over a bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger region. Now this is very much like what we've been doing with sums. We don't know what it means to add up an infinite number of numbers. So we just add up a finite number of numbers. We add up the first n numbers, and we look at what happens when n gets bigger and bigger and bigger. In both cases, if the limit exists, we say it converges. If the limit doesn't exist, we say it diverges. So you should be getting the sense that these improper integrals and these sums have something to do with each other. And they have a lot to do with each other in the particular setting that we have a function that's non-increasing. You often say a decreasing function, but strictly speaking, the function can be flat for a while and then head downhill. So we have a non-increasing function, and we usually want to talk about a positive function, but it can go to zero, in which case it's going to stay zero. So we have a non-increasing, non-negative function, but if you want to think about a decreasing positive function, that's fine. And then we're going to be interested in the integral from 1 to infinity. And the way we do that is we take the integral from 1 out to x. We got this integral, and that we have all that area. And if we call that capital F of x, that's the indefinite integral. And we know that that's an increasing function, or at least non-decreasing, because its derivative is the original function. That's the fundamental theorem of calculus. So it keeps going up and up and up and up. And that means that if we do the integral not from 1 to x, but if we do the integral from 1 to b, that you get an increasing function of b. And two things can happen. Either this function gets bigger and bigger and bigger without bound, that is, the whole thing goes to infinity, it diverges to infinity, or it approaches a finite limit as b goes to infinity. Those are the two possibilities. Now, what about infinite sums? Well, it's the same dichotomy. We've got the sum of a whole bunch of terms, and the more terms you get, the bigger Sn gets. So Sn is a non-decreasing sequence. Now remember the monotonic convergence theorem. If it's bounded, it converges. If it doesn't converge, it's not bounded. So either the partial sums go to infinity as you take more and more terms, or the whole thing converges. And the integral test says that whatever happens with the sum happens with the integral. Whatever happens with the integral happens with the sum. As long as we're dealing with a non-negative increasing function, if we add up the values of the functions, f of 1 plus f of 2 plus f of 3 plus f of 4 and so on, and we integrate the function, either both of these guys converge or they both diverge. So let's look at some examples where we can use this integral test. First example is we look at the sum of 1 over n squared plus 1. So that would be 1 half plus a fifth plus a tenth plus a 17th plus a 26th. And that's looking kind of ugly. And you say, well, okay, the terms are getting smaller, but are they getting smaller fast enough to converge? So you look at the integral. And the integral of 1 over 1 plus x squared, that's arctangent. So we get the arctangent at the upper limit, that's b, minus the arctangent of 1. And as b goes to infinity, the arctangent of b gets closer and closer to pi over 2. The arctangent of 1 is pi over 4. So this integral converges. In fact, it gives us the value pi over 4. Now, that doesn't say that this sum is pi over 4. It just says that this sum converges. It converges to some number. In fact, it's going to converge to a number slightly higher than pi over 4. We'll see later a relation between the value of the sum and the value of the integral. Okay. Next example, sum of 1 over x. Take 1 plus a half plus a third plus a fourth plus a fifth. This is called a harmonic series. Well, what do we know about the integral of 1 over x dx? Well, that's the natural log. So we get the natural log of b is the integral from 1 to b of 1 over x dx. And you take the natural log of bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger numbers, and that goes to infinity. So this diverges, so this sum diverges. Harmonic series diverges. Now, it diverges very, very slowly because log grows very, very, very slowly. But you take enough terms and you'll get bigger than any number you can name. Finally, we'll look at what's called P series. And instead of taking 1 over x, let's take 1 over a power of x. Maybe 1 over x squared or 1 over x cubed or 1 over the square root of x. We look at the integral of 1 over x to the p dx. And let's do that integral. If we do that integral, we get x to the 1 minus p divided by 1 minus p. And we want to see what happens to that as x goes to infinity. Well, if p is less than 1, then this is a positive power of x, and it blows up. If p is bigger than 1, then this is a negative power of x, and it shrinks. So this converges if p is bigger than 1. It diverges if p is less than 1. And we've just seen that if it's equal to 1, it diverges. So it converges if and only if. If with two f's means if and only if. So it converges if and only if p is greater than 1. So the corresponding sum, which is called a p series, converges if and only if p is greater than 1.